Again, my name is Tim Ergel. I'm the founder and CEO of AATC University, and I'm also the Chief Operating Officer of Power Solutions Group. We're a NEDA testing and commissioning company, which actually is going to relocate me from Phoenix into South Carolina, but I still don't get the snow. So, but anyway, without further ado, I'd like to introduce Kevin Sanders. He's with Hewlett-Packard Enterprise. He's going to share with us on the developing new data center strategies, incorporating SDDC and other technologies to create the right mix. Thank you.
Thank you. I was going to substitute this slide to read Apocalypse DCD 2017, but I decided I would keep the regular. I'm from Boston, and you know, snow is not a thing that we get worried about, but yesterday morning as I was deciding to come down, and they were predicting 24 inches up in New England, and they were saying things like life-threatening, world coming to an end, update your, you know, your will. My wife looked at me and said, "So let me get this right. You're leaving me alone here in the house." And I said, "We have an automatic backup generator. I'm a, you know, technology nerd." She said, "Which only works 50% of the time when it kicks on." So this morning I called up on the phone. I said, "Have we lost power yet?" She said, "No," but she said, it's falling all around the neighborhood. You know, it's going out. And I went through the whole list of things. Now remember, you got to go downstairs and hit the start button. This is not going to work out well. So I may be a permanent resident back in New York. if anybody has a spare couch for me to sleep on. A little bit of background if anyone doesn't know. So Hewlett-Packard Enterprise, a portion of the Hewlett-Packard Corporation split off a little bit ago. My group is HP-EYP, for those of you who are not familiar with EYP. Basically, my work with them started around 2008 or so. Hewlett-Packard hired them to help with their consolidation, which is fabled in the world. It's anything from 1 billion data centers down to six to several hundred down to six, but it was some very, very large number of data centers worldwide that we brought down to less than 10 over a period of time. EYP was one of the contributors to that consolidation, and as they say, they liked the company so much they bought it, and we're held as a completely separate subsidiary division of HPE right now. And in 2008, we merged. I'm a Hewlett-Packard person via Compaq, via Digital Equipment Corporation, gray hair. The strategy and consulting group that we had with their very, very strong engineering background. And since then, we have essentially designed about 65 million square feet of data center, and we're reformed under Data Center Facility Services now. So it's basically a soup to nuts a kind of consulting capability. Our group is the center section, and there's a reason why I'm doing this. This is the, for those of you who are like Car Talk, this is the Shameless Commerce Division comment about our marketing. Just to give you a sense for where we come from in the discussion that we're gonna have. In addition to having the capability of doing large-scale corporate data center strategies, from very, very large, from federal government secure facilities to the Fortune 100 to the Fortune 10, down to small grocers in Central Texas with three stores. Scale is not important to us, getting it right is. We're lucky enough to be able to have a whole other bunch of engineering services, hardcore engineering services. So the interesting perspective is being able to design strategies for corporations and then actually building them, and then seeing what you might have screwed up, small s. It's that feedback loop of understanding what you recommend and what it looks like later that sort of makes this job a very interesting job and gives you some perspective. And speaking of perspective, so what are we going to talk about here a little bit today? I'm going to talk about the technologies that I think are going to have an impact on data center strategies in this year, next year, and coming years. More or less. Similar to what Alan was just talking about, there's some overlap. In fact, I actually liked his two first items, the item on comprehensive data center strategy and then hyperscale in the edge. And that feeds right into two of the predictions that we have that are going to become important here. Seeing that large scale gives us a perspective that a lot of consultants don't have in terms of public and private and see what works large scale, small scale. Alan also said the same thing. There's a stunning lack still of joint cooperation between IT, facilities, and business units. All of you in this room who have ever tried to push any kind of data center strategy and run up against the columns, the stovepipes, are coming down very, very quickly. But inherent to any good and decent data center strategy, it's the requirement to have everybody in the enterprise cooperating. And most strategies fail because they're static. And they, both in the short term, economically, and long term, from a provisioning standpoint, they don't really get the job done. And I try and caution people that when you're putting a strategy together, you're not done with it. The three-ring binder doesn't go on the shelf and then you blindly live with that over the course of a couple of years. It's this kind of thing where every quarter, every 6 months, every year, it has to be updated and you need to be prepared to make some changes. And there are some technologies which are going to allow, I think, that to happen more than the static environments that we have today. All of us can attest to the fact that changes in IT architecture are having a huge effect on us. And for those of you in the school of, I come from the facility side of the house and I have to react to IT architecture, and those of you who are coming from the IT side of the house saying the facilities folks need to be integrated, the rate of change is now becoming almost impossible. And there are lots of times where I meet with the two different sides of the house and I sort of feel like the confessor. I go into the booth, I sit down, I pull the little curtain aside, person comes in and tells me all of their woes. And it's very interesting to hear the combinations of the what I call the barbell. A lot of issues all to one side, a lot of issues all to the other side, not a lot of commonality between the two of them. And that still is a problem. And we don't think of data centers as a source. A data center strategy doesn't necessarily reflect a thing, a physical data center. It reflects the ability to place your requirements, source them as necessary. And to some extent, the failures that I've seen in a lot of data center management organizations is their inability to understand that their job now is more of traffic cop than of builder. I'm going to build you a data center. Their job is to act as triage up front and say, this is what you need, and we're going to shunt it to these potential sources, these potential data center sources. Actually, it turns out to be a more exciting job because you get into areas you wouldn't normally touch. So what are some of the challenges? I think we've heard in a couple of the lectures this morning, we have a whole bunch of really old data centers. And so if you take people who have been around with a high degree of skill set, a lot of you in this room, and old data centers that were probably very well designed and built, and people who are really clever at keeping them alive, you can keep grandma on that resuscitator long after that plug should be pulled. And it's costing us a lot of money, costing us a lot of time, costing us a lot of effort. And their level of resiliency now required in a data center has changed radically, and those data centers are not prepared to handle those resiliency requirements or the application suites that are headed their way. Cloud, here to stay, no longer an issue. We don't have a good process for understanding in a strategy how we figure cloud. So the standard conversation. So as we're stepping through with a client, I'll show you the chart a little later, how their strategy is going to embrace change. We get to the idea of cloud and we hear, yeah, we got a few pilots going on, and we try and put into numbers, into costs, and into effort what that cloud strategy is going to be over a couple of years, so we understand where the applications are going, and they have an inability to really understand how it's going to affect them. And so the default is, well, I'm going to assume it's all going to stay with me, and if it parses off into the cloud somewhere, I'll deal with it later. Or we'll create some scratch space for a cloud pilot, the infamous word, and we'll be able to handle it, and then we'll let these guys talk about it. And then you hear the horror stories of, well, we've gone off and used some third-party cloud providers, and we have some things out there, but there's not a lot going on. And one of my favorite parables is large company on the other side of the river, a communications company we were working with 2 years ago, a very large communications company, said, we don't have really much going on in cloud. We have a little bit of a pilot here, and we're dealing with the finance folks and the CFOs. And I said, you guys have corporate credit cards? And they said, yes. I said, go and pull the codes for Microsoft, for Amazon, for all the major cloud providers. Run a scan on how much you're spending. Oh, no, we don't need to do that. It was not a good day when they did that. there was a lot of fessing up to do about stuff that's being sent out. And so there is more cloud afoot in your enterprises than you probably know about or want to know about. And being able to handle that in the process of data center sourcing is a critical issue. There's this whole concept, and we're going to do that next, of bimodal IT. All of us are in monomodal IT now. I build a data center. It runs like a rock. I get up every morning, and I measure how successful I am, because when I leave, we don't actually ever leave that data center, physically or mentally sometimes, it's running fine. And don't come to me and tell me you need something quickly. Those days are over. This whole concept of software-defined data centers, this thing's going to kill us in terms of strategy and design, because it is one of the things that completely upsets the way we design data centers and what the strategies look like and the core concentration of how much asset we need. And the whole, there's this concept of flex capacity. So think about this for a second. All of us provision IT gear out on the floor, and think of colo as an alternative. Flex capacity is basically when your IT supplier turns to you and says, you're not going to buy the gear any longer. You're basically going to, it's an off balance sheet. You're going to lease this from us, and we're going to put it in an amount to handle what you need today and a little more in a buffer, and we're going to talk a little more, future slide. And you basically have the ability to put flex capacity hardware in a co-location facility, have a complete data center capability, and you have very little capital. It's all OPEX, if that's what you need. Today's data center construct, nothing new here. Cloud is here to stay. That's the point of this. I think most people understand that the combination of facilities, platform, and whatever your cloud infrastructure is the basic essence now of a data center. And that thing that got slipped in, cloud. Many more of those are going to start. That chart in the next couple of years is going to start getting built out. More things are going to be added to platforms and facilities than we did before as the standard construct. So this whole concept of bimodal, it's obvious that enterprises need to have the static, old-fashioned kind of reliable data center infrastructure. But you can't live without having the ability to react very quickly. And what we're basically looking at is the necessity to have two different kinds of architectures, data center architectures, in this bimodal world. This is not I think it's going to happen. This is, in fact, happening. It's happened in some industries a lot faster than others. As an example of that, any of you who are in retail clothing or wholesale clothing or even in the design retail space, one of the ways you sell now to the generation that has, doesn't have grandchildren like me, is I come in the morning and I have my phone and I'm looking up what the latest fashion item is. And it changes every 3, 4, 5 days, every week. When something hot comes out, the knockoff people are out there, retailers slam it out on the street. They have applications that they launch every week, week and a half, to get people incented to keep moving. That group has realized that a static capability for the back end doesn't work any longer. They need to have a data center capability to launch applications, get it out on the street, handle orders, get feedback, and make another change in a week and a half. And that has tremendous churn and tremendous change in a data center that most of us grew up not wanting. Don't come and tell me that I have to revision quickly, or I got a new app stack I have to support, or you need new communications capability. So you basically have this philosophical wall getting slammed down the middle right now. And that gives us the obligatory build slide. Sorry for the amount of time it takes for this boy to go. I think we actually have this in two parts here. And this whole concept of core IT, rock solid, don't change, I'm not going to change this. You can't afford to change this. You know, all jokes aside, this is what the corporation runs on and expects to have. There's just no way out of it. And for some industries that have regulatory environments and others, you cannot modify this. It has to be the same. Finance and banking and pharma and hospital and those are healthcare. Those are things that can't change. But on the other side, you have this whole concept of fluid. I need to be able to have this change. That is a data center source, and you need to be able to handle that. It may require a subdivision. It may require a separate capability, but you have to have the ability to handle that in a given strategy. And why is it different? We talked about in core IT, reliability is it. There is no excuse. The reality is in fluid IT, the measure isn't necessarily so much reliability, it's agility. And so my daughter-in-law uses those retail apps. She's in the fashion industry. And she's perfectly accepting of the fact that, you know, she'll go on in a couple of hours, the app may be a little unstable, it may take a while to get back. They have a different level of acceptance in terms of what is considered a requirement there. But she looks at wanting to have that change happen, that churn on a frequent basis. And, you know, Core IT is PUE, we just talked about it, price for performance. How cheap can you make it? On the other side, Fluid IT is about revenue. It can drive revenue more than the static side of the house can. Governance is a big issue. You know, plan-driven approach on core. On the other side, it really is continuous change. There is some lapsing in the rules in terms of governance in that space. My friends, it. All right, SDDC. So today, the data centers we build are locked down and static. I have rows, I have storage, I have processors, I have networks, end of aisle, center aisle, I have cabling, it's all there, it's predefined, and life is good. And we can continue to live with that, but there's this growing thing that all of you, who's familiar with software-driven data centers and the component pieces? We've all heard about it. Anyone actually rocking an SDDC? Nope, you will very quickly, because the economics are overwhelming. If you thought that consolidating data centers and virtualization of, you know, hardware got you something, SDDC allows you to grab that sponge and squeeze it so hard and drive cost out after the initial investments, it's insane. And the minute the CFO finds out about it, your lives are going to change, because the common answer is going to be, I want one of those. I want to have the ability. It's not trivial, mind you, but it is a way of using software to provision what you normally would do in a static environment. And why is that important to a strategy? So four basic components to it, defined compute, storage, networks, and the facility even of itself. It allows you to dynamically allocate capability. So as an example, your network gear is not placed like it normally would be. The whole design of the floor, the whole overall data center layout is generally a lot different in a software-defined data center than you would have in a normal static, which means if you're planning to build data centers and that's part of a strategy, this is part of the Q&A you have to have in terms of planning to understand the amount of design changes you have in order to entertain one of these in a logical fashion. And this is coming, because the application side people are going to drive the bus over us all unless we're capable of handling this in the very near future. Everything from cabling to how you provision, all of us are very proud of the fact that we talk about automated provisioning, which really in many instances is nothing more than I have a piece of software which puts the form up in front of you and you type in, I'd like to have a this and I'd like to have that, and it tells you, here's your record number and go away, I'll get back to you soon, in terms of having that stack prepared. This is dynamic, and the software literally will change during the course of the day and set different application runs for those that are static and be able to handle the fluid IT and reallocate compute, storage, and network resources dynamically as required. There are some fairly complex layers of software involved. Not going to do the full lecture here today unless you want to stay around and have that root canal. But the biggest issue is its effect on growth and enterprise strategy. I don't think I'm exaggerating when I say in 3 to 5 years, the majority of the data centers out there are going to be designed, new data centers are going to be designed around this. It is so important that co-location providers have spent time with us saying, can you tell us what clients and what markets are looking for this, and can you help provide some consulting support to us for how we need to do some layout to be able to handle this? And many colos are going to start using this as a marketing advantage, saying, we're ready for this. If you want to come and install an SDDC, we have hands and feet people who can handle it. We understand the whole concept. We understand the layout. We understand the density differences. We understand the power and the air handling requirements that are radically different than standard colo. And when it gets that far down the line to that kind of sourcing capability, it becomes a real thing. I talked a little bit about this whole concept of flex capacity. And it really, you know, there's no real magic in this. You need to find out how the IT side of the house is going to start building and providing services. I have a number of clients who instead of buying the whole rack of gear for growth, buy what essentially is what they need, and the service provider provides a buffer. Now, we have this, many other companies do, so this is not shameless car talk division. This is out there, lots of folks have it. You need more, it's a buffer. And instead of provisioning, you basically write a change order and they turn it on as necessary or turn it off. So your capacity, your storage, your compute, and at some level your networking capabilities are OPEX based, not CAPEX based. And if you marry that to co-location, you basically can build a bloody great data center on very little cash if cash flow is an important issue. Some of the reasons why, I think you guys probably get this, in fact, Alan before me talked about this, over-provisioning rampant right now. The old days, let's build more. We never want to be caught short. Too much money now to get that done. Slow performance issues because we're trying to squeeze everything we can out of our hardware. The kind of flex stuff gives the ability to walk past that. And it really is the issue about adding capacity and having to sit through the CAR and get the stuff on the floor and, you know, the rest of that. All right, another issue. How many of you who either work in or know or plan data centers are using modular of any level, from micro all the way up to full modular site? It's starting to get a little, all right. I don't know why everyone isn't doing this. This is the thing, I think, for the next 4, 5, 6 years. I have clients that come to me and say, we're out of capacity, help us grow. I think we need to stick build an extension or go find a new data center. And by the time we do the future state forecasting, we find out that the requirements are fairly modest and there's no reason why I simply don't roll up a pod or some kind of containerized device, either place it on the floor in the building, place it on a pad right outside the wall, blow a hole through, and put some covering protection on it. There are ways to handle and use modular. I have two clients who, brand new data centers, simply went and bought a warehouse with a low level of environmental control. So they just wanted an envelope. And into that warehouse, pads went in and they dropped pods in. They did not build it, a data center. Their cost went down dramatically. And the folks who work in that data center love it because they can put all the foosball and pool tables they need in the far corner of this warehouse and not be accused of having anything on the data center floor. You think I'm kidding you, don't you? You really think I'm kidding you? This thing, and Alan was talking about this too, this sort of hyperscale and then the edge. We have clients when we're doing these strategies that go, and I've got 78 closets. Across 3 states, they're, a couple hundred square feet, they're killing me, and we have to figure out how to plan for them, and my first reaction is, no, give the closets back, don't do that any longer. Micro data center, shameless car talk division, okay? We have one on the floor, there are others. Different than an enclosed rack, this thing comes complete with power and air handling, and I mean, it is a data center in a box with a tether cable, which comes out of the top. You can place it on a floor with people working. No need for closets any longer. People can't get into it. You don't have to worry about the floor drain upstairs in the closet, leaking and coming down on your closet, or someone deciding they want to get to the slop sink next to, this place you have it. If you're doing edge services, small offices, and you need to have a controlled environment, I don't know why people are still talking about, please build me a teeny data center someplace. Drop it in a box and roll the bloody thing out onto the floor. And as I said, we have one, go see it. It really becomes a standard issue when you're doing your strategies to say, if it is of this scale, we are no longer going to take up real estate. This thing goes on the floor, we drop in a box, it rolls out. The other thing is mergers and acquisitions for pods. I have a lot of companies that are merging now, people coming together and splitting, and we get the panic phone call, we have to divest ourselves or bring stuff in and we need to build or rebuild data centers, and no. Other than co-location as a sourcing option, we talk about using pods or modular. Let's find a space, let's get a workspace that's a neutral party, and I can deliver a data center in 6 months or less, 4 months or less, as necessary depending upon the size and scale. And we're not using these in strategies. One of my favorite slides, people say, but I have a strategy. It's not a data center design, okay? It's a different thing. We're switching here into a little bit of a strategy piece, and I always get this. can I see your strategy to date? And what I get is a spec for what a data center is supposed to look like, not a data center strategy, large scale, went the wrong direction. All right, simple view what a data center strategy contains in a modern era. Yet don't start, even though we all want to, from the data center sourcing side. You start from the other side. And this is the point about having the cross organizations work from. The first place you start is this whole concept of what the future state IT architecture is. If you do not understand what you guys need to run your app portfolios, you have no business putting a strategy together. That's your first stop. And also, if you make these guys your friends, you have all the support in the bloody world behind you. Secondly, solve the issue about cloud and its effect on how fast you're moving. Disaster recovery, agility, we talked about organic growth, M&A, mergers and acquisitions. Probably 20% of my clients now are getting murdered because of M&A, and we talk about developing a thing called an M&A playbook, which is, I don't know when it's going to happen, but I have a process for getting it done, running all the way up to data center strategies on the other side. That holistically brings all three groups together. Right mix strategy, we talked about collaboration. Really? You're not convincing the technology guys with your strategy. The person you are selling to is the CFO. Say that again. The person I'm selling to is the CFO. Because a data center, a corporate or an enterprise or a worldwide data center strategy has very little to do with the technology because they take it for granted that you figured all that out. It has everything to do with the cash flow. And if you don't get the check written, you don't have a strategy. And so I tell people the biggest failure in the world is to roll in, and when I ask the question, so what does the CFO think about this? They go, we haven't gone to him yet. My price doubles. Because I now have to deal with that person. Okay, and that's not gonna be a pretty discussion. And my point is, who do you play with? You play to the CFO at the outside because someone has to handle it. You play to the CTO in terms of his or her responsibility to let you know what the technologies are. You don't have to bear the whole brunt of this. Hot list, why they fail. I have to tell you that one of the reasons why most of the plans fail are things like this, a completely unrealistic DR strategy. I've had some companies tell me they've never actually exercised a DR strategy integrated into their enterprise IT, and they're afraid to do it, and they probably could not reconstitute. And yet you have to approach DR as part of any kind of enterprise strategy, not just from a hardware and facility standpoint. It really turns out to be what-if modeling. A strategy which contains all the elements that we talked about really says, here are a couple of scenarios. Scenario 1, 2, and 3, they have altering data center sourcing components. They have different cost timelines for TCOs. They have to be tailored to both the OPEX and CAPEX flows that the CFO wants. That is what the output is that goes to the board. The board looks at this from here are a couple of scenarios, here are the cash flows, they've been tailored to what we can afford. This is the one that we pick. And anything less than that, a total technology orientation, is probably not going to cut it. Has to contain a bunch of profiles. One thing that we never talk about is a risk profile. And one of the ways to get people to understand why complexity is required and why money needs to be spent is this whole concept of risk. And what is the risk profile of this corporation or this entity? How much resiliency do they need? Because risk is simply money. How much do you want to spend to cover risk? It's insurance. That's a flat discussion that drives everything from there. It drives your IT, it drives your facility strategy. This whole concept of the data center profile, what you want to build, is actually, these two are well understood. It's that which is often avoided, and this, the financial profile. Finding out in advance, are you CapEx rich? Are you OpEx rich? Do you have to have a mix? Tell me how you want it to spend, because any decent strategy can tailor itself to the cash flows required. And finally, this is my brother-in-law. No. We got to stop using the same approaches. I think everyone has probably said this in every presentation I've heard this morning. You can't expect to take the same approach and continue to be successful in today's world. This rate of change is something that you shouldn't look at as a fear. You need to look at it as something to embrace. Questions? One? Yes.
I have to. I'm the moderator.
There you go.
In terms of the condense, and this is kind of a preview on our session at 4 o'clock, but the consolidated delivery schedule. You mentioned modular, you mentioned micro-modular. And then we're also kind of keeping in tune with Uptime Institute and their philosophies. So, you know, here we have a staff that has to understand what a tier three or tier four data center is, and we're delivering in weeks. How do we bridge that gap?
It's very difficult. You can't deliver it in weeks, and you know that. There are ways to do it. It depends upon the scale. Small scale, you can. Some of these micro data centers can be built and designed, depending upon their tethering capabilities, to reach a tier three capability if required. If you need large scale tier three, tier four, you cannot build it that fast, you know that. You can't remediate something that quickly. You can conceivably go and acquire co-location capabilities very rapidly. It depends upon how complex your requirement is gonna be. But that gets to the risk profile. Tiering is nothing more than the description of risk, how I'm gonna handle it in terms of resiliency. And I often say, everyone thinks it needs to be tier three, and what you may be is needing a multi-tier level. I often find that people settle to build to the highest tier level, and yet I have clients that we advise build a lot of tier two, and some tier three, and some tier four, and go with a multi-tier strategy. You can manage all of them, it's cheaper, you can deliver, as you know, tier two faster, you can remediate it faster, and you can other tier levels. So it's that understanding of risk and the application profile that leads you to the tiering and ultimately what you need to provision.
Kevin, what's some of the challenges you're hearing getting from clients around, you have the conversation around software-defined data center?
Not understanding it clearly, not understanding component pieces. There needs to be a sort of national discussion around SDDC in our business 101, what it really means. As typical, it's being driven by a lot of marketing coming from a lot of different companies trying to define SDDC best as they can for their product set. The reality is there is a core in the center, which is true to all of them. It does affect your IT architecture. It has to do with the IT folks and the facilities people. It's one of those rare occasions both parties don't have a lot of background in this topic. Usually it's one or the other. And so this is a great opportunity for both parties to get together and form under the IT architecture piece, this group which says, how do we investigate the use of this and how do we pilot and use SDDC? And I always tell people, pilot the heck out of this. Take a small data center, rebuild it, set up an infrastructure, let the applications developers understand what they need to live, run that, and it will then sell itself internally. Don't try and do it large scale. Although it can be done large scale if you have the assets and the consulting support quite easily.